comes back, and now our farmers can't even afford it. It becomes so expensive. So manufacturing becomes very relevant and also linked to food security, because if we are able to make our own fertilizers, we shall be better off. Today, Kenya has oil and gas. We used to say that we could not manufacture our fertilizer because we had no gas. Now we have gas. But why can't we manufacture nitrogenous fertilizer? Because gas is the source of ammonia, which then combined with, and once you have gas, then you have ammonia, you can now make a wide range of other nitrogenous fertilizers, which our farmers need badly. Before they plant in February, January, they cry that where are the fertilizers? So the topic of manufacturing is very relevant. And therefore, in our discussion, let's see how we can be able to help in changing these raw materials into high-value products, which will help us. I'll come back to that at the end of my address. So the worsening tendency in Africa is due to difficult global economic inclinations and also failing environmental conditions, including low investment in technology, like water, which is very important for the environment and for human health. Can you believe that in Africa, water, which is so important for our agriculture, for our health, is only about 4%. When you compare that to Latin America, it's about 25%. I guess, I always say when I'm teaching, tell me, if someone can tell me that, I'll give them something for lunch. I will tell my students, how much is Asia investing in water? Or some say, about 5%, 10%, very important. The answer is Asia as a whole, which is a very wet continent compared to ours, have invested 45% in on water. No wonder we are importing our rice from Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, China. The water is important, and therefore, that 4% is not sufficient. In fact, that 4% is mainly North Africa, Southern Africa. The middle here, maybe 1 or 2%. There's something for you to research on. The researchers find out how much are we investing in water. We need to build more dams, more water pans. Now that I passed through the narrow sometimes, see now the water pans have helped. The science used to suffer from finding water when it's dry. But those small water pans are beginning to help. So we need to explore ways of investing more in water. Therefore, as we look at by the way, agriculture uses 2/3 of water. Big major use of water. And industry also needs some for domestic and for health. So as we continue, I think already the climate change or climate availability has been referred to. It has now complicated the petrol planning and human implementation. In food, it makes the problem the aflatoxin. When farmers harvest during wet period, we eat sorghum, millet, wheat, maize, that fungus has been as flowers, affects the crop, and although it may look clean, it is really high in aflatoxin, which is carcinogenic. And if you feel it, some say, okay, it's not good for eating, but let's give it to our animal for milk. It also comes up in milk, and Professor Shibairu, when was dean at the vet, they know that very well, that our belief in the vet, in pharmacology, were the first to identify that, oh, aflatoxin is found in milk. And therefore, maize condemned because it is no good, can still be harmful. You can see how universities can play a big role. Later on, I'll be telling you as a university, always following problems, what can you do to attack some of these problems? So therefore, drought, floods, temperature fluctuation. This year, the farmers have been very confused. I was talking to the driver as we came from Sumu. Some people have refused to plant because they planted poor germination, and then again the seed that they used, they applied fertilizer. Some planted later, but this year in many parts, the crops are not as good. Because the climate change is making it very difficult to tell that to be ready to plant in X month or harvest around this time. Again, that's something which as researchers, we have a challenge to keep on working with others to see how we can face climate change. Another major constraint to food nutrition security is declining soil fertility. Not just in Kenya, but in Africa. And here I want to go back to a very old study. In 1960, no farmers used to practice what is called shifting cultivation. When land was tired, they moved to somewhere else. But by 1970, serious nutrient depletion started. And by 2000, fertilizer use was almost vital. Recently, farmers in most of our countries are using very little amount of fertilizer, 15 kilograms, but they need it. That is why some of our yields are very low. And even the food we eat, because it's not well fertilized, may be lacking in certain nutrients. So we are talking about evidence. We need evidence that these soils are tired, the organic matter has gone down, pH is declining, and all that is happening. So some of you, as I will refer later, do research to show that when the farmers are complaining about the pH in washing tissues, and the growing maize with growing areas have gone down. Is it true? Confirm it by doing the research and analysis. And this is where we have a very important chance today, this week in this conference, to be able to provide that evidence to policymakers. We just finished a PhD study with one of my students called Mwanga, who's working in Karamoja, in about four sub-counties of Kotido. He's using now Landsat. He followed almost a 30-year trend of land use. And it showed that as people move from woodland, or natural forest, woodland, grassland, and cultivation, suddenly soil fertility goes down. Already two papers have been published already, and the five times I talk about indigenous knowledge. In that study, we brought in indigenous knowledge. What the Karamoja people do about soil? It's amazing when you read the thesis, what they associate with declining soil fertility, the new types of weeds, the hardening. So those farmers, those are not people, they are not stupid, they know. Use them also as good research to bring in some of these aspects. So now I want to go to the second part of my address, which is now referring to the evidence. I think I've touched a bit on some of the evidence we have to be able to solve some of the problems. I like the logo of Kibabii University, and so it's a very nice logo. Says knowledge for development. That's fantastic. That is what we are here to discuss today, because knowledge is important. The Bible tells us in Hosea 4, verse 6, that my people are destroyed. Some versions say perished for lack of knowledge. It continues and read it at the end of the verse. So you have chosen a very suitable logo. Don't let people die or be destroyed for lack of knowledge. Continue pursuing this thing, because the experience from our countries in Eastern Africa, Kenya, Uganda, Burundi, Rwanda, Tanzania, is very relevant today, because in 2011, my contemporary and a colleague from Makerere called Professor Patrick Baihayo and I, we were asked to review, but could tell us what have we gone through since we attained independence. Now, independence was a big landmark. Now, 50 years, we were celebrating. So we were tasked for almost 6 months, 1 year. At the end of the review, we had a conference in Kampala. We reported on very many areas that could take a whole 2 or 3, 4 hours. just summarized some of the major findings, what we found out. By the way, in 1960, the whole of Africa was food secure. Though there were pockets of hunger here and there, in fact, children named and were so torn, small hunger, but they are not as serious as they are today. And now those names, Okorokoro, and here in Bukoba, I'm sure you also have some. But after 1962, after independence, I don't know what happened. By the way, that time India was really starting, India, Pakistan, they had a big pocket. And that's how the Green Revolution came up, because there are people who had foreseen someone called Malthus, a British economist, had predicted that the way the world population is growing logarithmically. But the way we are producing food is arithmetic. And those two curves will never meet. And therefore, there will be a crisis. There will be a doom when the world will almost fall apart with the lack of. So some people began doing some work in Mexico, which later on, by 1970, brought in some very high-yielding varieties. That's the story of the Green Revolution. And the only Nobel Prize in agriculture is by somebody called Norman Borlaug. No Nobel Prize is mainly for chemists, physicists, and the medical people get many of them, except for mathematicians. Does somebody know why? Why don't mathematicians get Nobel Prize? Anyone know? In the audience? This is a university audience. You do not know why Nobel Prize? It's only for physicists, biologists. Because peace. The Nobel Prize follow up that with the stuff. But the answer is that Nobel, who was the discoverer of the bomb, made a lot of money. And when he was about to die, he wrote a will that the money from the proceeds is kept to be awarded to scholars like you. But today, it's almost August, around July, August, many announcements are made about Nobel laureate. The only got two in Kenya, Wangari Maathai, and currently Professor Richard Bingo in geography. But he put in his way that the prize did not go to mathematicians. I'm sorry for my friends, mathematicians. Because he had a girlfriend who was not a mathematician. That's why you don't have a great prize for those areas. So, agriculture is important. So the first Nobel laureate in agriculture, called Norman Borlaug, established a fund called African Food Prize. Every year, August, they get the best African workers and good work to go to Des Moines, Iowa, to receive the prize. So as you do the research, think about some of those distinguished awards which reward researchers who help you in working. Good. Maybe I think I will a bit digress from my speech. But what I was trying to say is that we were food secure in 1960. Today, if you look at the African Development Bank report, our food bill is more than almost approaching $600 billion food import into Africa. Nigeria is one of the largest importers of rice. Even Kenya, we also import our rice. And therefore, if you are able to do research, have enough food, we'll be healthy. That money will be saved, to be spent somewhere on healthcare, and so on. So at this juncture, as I analyzed this PPA report, it may be very boring that because we went through all the crops which we eat, I may call them our food basket. Our food basket is mainly the staples, the food which we eat every day, the maize, the potato, the banana for Uganda and Rwanda, beans and so on. By the way, we human beings, we need to contribute almost 60% of our energy comes from crops. That's why most people in crops get more money, and the animal scientists complain that how come that you can go in and crowd and get more money. You see, as crop supply and most of our energy, that will also do contribute. Therefore, our bread basket in East Africa is very much grain oriented. When there's no grains, we suffer. In Kenya, for example, maize production is synonymous with food insecurity because it is a staple to over 90% of the population. Maize occupies 1.6 million hectares of land, and even that one is not enough. In Kenya, production of maize for the last 10 to 20 years has been below demand, except last year, 2017, we had some surplus. That supply has almost been wiped. So we have a problem because we share maize in many other countries, Zimbabwe, Zambia, and so on. So we need to see how can we conserve land to have enough maize, or can we have more technologies so that we have higher yields to avoid that land clearing, which we have witnessed in many parts of our country, including the one I referred to next door in Uganda. I can go through all these crops, the rice, of course, Tanzania is the leading producer of rice in East Africa, but their rice is produced mainly from grain-fed, about 29% is irrigated, but the yields are very low, about 1.5-2 tons per hectare. And you know, Egypt, up north, using our Nile River, they get 10 tons of rice per hectare. Therefore, we need to be doing more about breeding, agronomy, where our yields can be higher. So if we go through all those crops, rice, which is a major, and also now, somehow I think by our tastes are changing. When I was young, rice was only eaten when there was at a Christmas or some very special wedding. Now, if there's no rice in your house for 2 days, you'll see by a delegation that my brother put a leo. So those changing habits are not helping us. We have no land for wheat, yet we need a lot of bread. So we also need the legumes, the pulses. That's where you have a group of the beans, cowpeas, groundnuts, peas, grams, field peas, which are important in complementing the staples because they give us the protein to balance our diet. And again here, Uganda, the major supplier of our beans, also Rwanda. My colleague here confirmed that Rwanda, yes, the major. We don't have enough beans in Kenya. Roots and tubers are also important. Cassava, sweet potato, taro roots. So the more we can diversify our diet, it's good for health, but also for our country. We just have all the land, just maize and so on. Uganda is unique in our region because it is the only country where banana is the staple. FAO had a very hard time until I went there to look at people. FAO comes here every August to assess food security, and they base it purely on grains. Because no, Uganda, the grains are not important. When they produce maize, they produce it for Kenyans. They call it kaunga. And they are, by the way, they are the number two in India, in the whole world. Uganda is number 2 in banana production, next to India. They used to produce their bananas in a place called Biogadere. After 30, 40 years, that's the soil in that area got exhausted. Now they have moved to Masaka and the western part. Again, you can see, over time, the soil, the land, get exhausted and find a way to either go replenish. We also have cash crops, coffee, tea, sugarcane, which are also relevant to food security because they work. Again, in these countries, we have witnessed a decline in forests, except for Rwanda. Most of our countries are really developed these powers, which in one day can clear a bit of the trees. They make money, but in the end, it's a big problem. So what kind of solution can we put forward? This is a long list of problems. We need to see how we can contribute to those problems. And there are many. At one time, the Inter-Academy of Science, I think by the Indian Academy of Science and the American Academy of Science, chaired by very powerful people, reviewed for 3 years the problems of Africa and African agriculture. The reports are available, and those problems are always increasing. And even the SDGs cannot solve all of them. So I am trying to propose a few solutions, not exhaustively, to help us address some of these problems. And for example, what kind of solutions can we propose to solve the problem of food nutrition security? The first one I come up with, that delivering the Big Four agenda requires a comprehensive multi-sectoral approach coupled with calls for innovative action from all stakeholders. To this end, the conference should consider or support the establishment of partnerships and networks with government, civil society organizations, academia, and research organizations. The world is now moving to more and more multi-institutional, multidisciplinary teams to solve problems. And a conference like here, we have this week, will help you to present the case. One of my former boss, when I was in West Africa, told me that, look here, most solutions are not solved on the conference. A lot of work is done in the corridors. Corridor in the coffee and tea break, dinner in the evening. So use the chance you have here to know your colleagues, interact with them. The next time you are submitting a proposal, you can say, yes, I know so-and-so from the University of Benda. I know so-and-so from the University of, because most of this ground now wants you to have partners from the north, from the south, from the east, to be able to get big grants to do research and move forward. Also promote integrated soil fertility management to enhance soil nutrient depletion in order to produce nutrient-dense crops. In 2006, the then president of Asante called a conference in Abuja, trying to convince African government that let's use more fertilizers. Some countries are using only 1 kilogram per hectare per year. Some are about 10. Kenya made about 20 or 20 or 30. But that is far, far below what other countries use. So that area remains a problem, that how can we increase our use of fertilizer? It's a combination of income. If farmers don't have income, they will not buy the fertilizer. And therefore also the other areas is the importance of mechanization in improving efficiency and boosting agricultural production. It's a synergy with the manufacturing. Mechanization can not only play an important role in relieving drudgery, but can also be instrumental in attracting and retaining the youth in agriculture. Our youth cannot use the jembes and the pangas, which our grandmother used to use for weeding or planting. If they have a nice tractor, which can like a robot, they will sit there and the plant, weed, harvest, stop. So this area which have been done can also help us to support our cause. Let's support training programs aimed at transforming people's mindset to think out of the box, to think positively towards agriculture and food security, even healthcare, as viable, attractive means of sustainable livelihood. Now, things happen with individuals, but when people work as a group, it was sometimes like sociologists call it collective action. When people around here agree to have a forest, a wood lodge, they will preserve it. But if they don't like it, they'll cut it also. Today there's somebody in Kitui called Bishop Masika. Bishop Masika is a retired teacher. When he retired, of course, when you retire, you have so many things to do. One time he read the papers, and they said so that one of the MPs died in this area from a flood. Those rivers in Kampani can be dry in the morning, and evening they are full. And then later on, he found that this MP was an engineer. 3 months later, he reads and he finds that now children are dying from hunger. And they said, now, what a paradox. 3 months ago, we lost an MP, an engineer, from flood on maybe either River Yata or one of those rivers in Kibabii. Now, 3 months later, children are dying from hunger. What's the problem? So he started an NGO, which is now convincing people to work as groups to dig a small pond or water pond. From that pond, you tell them, of course, okay, you get 1 acre. If you are 1 acre, divide it into four. If all Kenyans have maize, 1 acre is for maize, 1 acre for beans and vegetables, 1 acre for some other crops, and over 1 acre for your house or homestead. You know, today, to summarize Mr. Masika's what he was, his philosophy was that they are depending so much on food aid. Before food aid comes, nothing happens. Now, there's a cumber way of calling, they're not throwing away food aid. They started by calling people who are in towns, who are earning about 4,000 shillings a month, they couldn't go home. Now they're millionaires. They're now exporting food to Europe just by having water pumps which they collect when it's raining. And take them for 2 or 3, 4 months. Very innovative ways of see what he's doing. Now he's in Turkana and many other countries. So this university has a chance. The University of Nairobi was working with him. Now we put him as one of our partners. They're their students and the former dean, the dean is here, Professor Shibahiru, knows that we should look for ways how to solve problems of drought, food insecurity, and healthcare. Number 5, support social protection as a means of mitigating food insecurity, universal healthcare among the vulnerable groups. Revamp investment and initiative aimed at increasing availability of water. I think I've said that water is very important. So Masika is one of those. Water is crucial for health and for other things. Support the establishment of food banks for collection and redistribution or surplus. You know, the school milk, some of you who are beneficiary, you can't have forgotten those school milk. Some families benefited that they were able to overcome that standing. We can go back to health and healthcare. Initiation of agro processing and establishment of agro food parks in urban and even peri urban areas. Investment in water infrastructure. Recognition and the important contribution by the livestock sector. You know, we know that very poor people, the last thing they will have is chicken. It's a paper by somebody called World Bank, that poor people keep animals. Sometimes they have only one goat. That's their biggest resource. So as much as we'll be preaching about crops, that's chicken. When they eat it that day, they are protein. Some of us, when they are young, like when your uncle comes to visit, but that day, a chicken will die. Therefore, you be away from my organic, which I've been eating for a whole month. So livestock are important, and anything I can do to support them would be welcome. Women play a crucial role in food security and even healthcare. So therefore, mainstreaming gender into all that we do is crucial. Though women are the primary producers of food in Africa, women produce 70% of the food that the men, of course, rely on the money for. What men do? Men maybe go do other things. Acknowledge the fundamental role played by academia, research institutions in the fight against hunger and malnutrition. I think what they're doing today is just one example. Universities and other research institutions involved in generating data for general development, encourage and reward young, innovative scholars by establishing a competitive transformation challenge, what for either fund, support, or a prize around the areas which we are discussing. Some of one way to retain staff is to just award them. For what they have done, acknowledge their contribution, so that at least they are able to stay. I know a country, Africa, which is very, very fond of honoring their scientists when they achieve, they are given something, it may not be, but it's the fact that they have been honored, make people stay. Support new ways of disseminating research findings. The Vice Chancellor and other speakers have heard about that one. It's very important that you communicate your findings through the normal channels, publications, and research. And I'll come back to that later on when I address the staff and the university. Link knowledge with policy actions by providing opportunities for sharing. By the way, policy benefit from science. Policy is based on information. Well, one of the key speakers will be addressing this area later on in our discussion. And land governance, which is sensitive to wanton and economic fragmentation of land, requires thorough research. In Kenya, to realize our affordable housing, we need approximately 14,000 acres of land spread across five major urban towns like Nairobi, Mombasa, Nakuru, Kisumu, Eldoret. That land will be at the opportunity cost of producing something. But the challenge we have today is that people are subdividing very valuable land. Kenyans love their land. And that's a policy which will arrest that subdivision. When you see, I don't know how many of you are going to Keroka, or even Kiambu, land, very, very valuable land. It's now 2 or 3, 4 acres. Everybody has a household here and there. They want water, they want the road. One is in the top of the valley. What are we doing as universities? We are seeing our good land getting into tarmac and roads. That land we need it for food. Why can't we propose that we go in settlement, live in a smaller place, but you see that their land can do that, can work that land as a cooperative. That kind of proposal can only come from universities working together with others. Because our policy is freehand. In West Africa, most of them live in villages. And therefore, land is available. It's never a problem. When you want to build, you go to the chief,